Hi, everybody. I'm Donna Baker, and this is my Faces of Monrovia program here on KGEM. I would like to first of all thank KGEM for coming up with this idea of turning my online interviews into an in-person interview process. And I have interviewed some fantastic people, but today I am so happy to introduce you to my good friend, Barbara Gholar, and longtime Monrovian.
Hi,
Barbara, how are you? It's so good to see you in person.
I know, it's been a while.
It has been a while. So I was rereading your interview that we did, actually 2 years ago we did your interview,
I can't believe it was. I know, that's crazy.
Yeah, you were one of my first people, I think. So in fact, I think it was during Black History Month in 2022 that I interviewed you.
It was around that period of time.
Yeah, yeah. So the first thing I want to talk to you about is tell us about being a Monrovian. I know you were born and raised here, so tell me about being born and raised here and having family here and what it was like growing up in Monrovia during those times.
Well, first of all, you know, I love Monrovia.
Don't we all?
Yeah. And I had a very good childhood. I had, and I don't know about any other street or block, I should say, because on our block, it was very diverse.
What street was that?
Cypress,
okay.
Yeah, between Myrtle and Ivy.
Okay.
Yeah. And actually, now I'm finding out that thanks to the Parker family and others, that those of us that lived on between Myrtle and Ivy went to Santa Fe as opposed to going to Huntington.
Oh, okay.
Yes. And so,
Santa Fe was pretty new then, right?
No.
Okay.
Santa Fe was elementary school.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So now it's a middle school.
It's a middle school. Yeah, and it's so funny because my two younger, not younger, but the middle-ish siblings, they went to Santa Fe as elementary, but then the following year they turned it to...
So they stayed in one
they
place.
They stayed in one place.
That's interesting.
Yes. As opposed to, you know, it was a big deal, you know, finishing sixth grade and going up to Clifton, and then from the Clifton going up to the high school. But they missed that step. You know, they continued from kinder all the way up to the eighth grade, and then
I did not know that was the history of Santa Fe.
Yes.
That's interesting.
Yes. And it's also It's also funny that I know we're going to talk about it later on, but you know, during Black History Month, the first time that I went back to Santa Fe, it was the weirdest feeling.
Yeah.
Because I'm thinking, oh, this used to be this was that, you know. And then also sharing with the students, because they're looking at me like, and
well, you were a kindergarten teacher somewhere, right?
Yeah, at Foothill Preschool.
At Foothill Preschool.
Yes.
Foothill Presbyterian?
No, Foothill Preschool on Foothill Boulevard between Ivy and Canyon, the little blue school.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the little blue school. That's what you call it.
Yeah. I know which one you're talking about.
Oh, yeah. Okay, got it.
Yeah. I know where that is. So how did your family end up in Monrovia? Were your parents born and raised here too?
No. My dad is from Chicago, born in Mississippi, then went to Chicago, and then from Chicago he moved. My mom was born in Detroit, Michigan.
Oh,
yeah.
So
I don't really know how they met, but anyway.
You don't?
No, that's great. Well, you know who knows is Joni, but unfortunately.
Yeah. Sorry about Joni.
Yeah. And then we lived on Sherman, and then Mom and Daddy bought the house on Cypress when I was 2 years old. Yeah. Joni was three.
And how many siblings did you
have? There's five of us.
Five of you. Okay, and you all grew up here and went to school here?
Every last one of us.
What is your favorite thing about Monrovia, having
Monrovia
grown up
days.
Here? Monrovia days.
Yes, because
really?
That was, back in the day, that was a big deal. You got special, you know, people that even moved away came back. That was almost like Monrovia's
a reunion.
Because you got special outfits to go to Monrovia days.
Wow.
Because I don't know if you were you? Well,
I moved here in 87, and it was still on Foothill then, and they all hung out at the Elks Lodge on the lawn and watched the parade
go by.
But
what used to happen is that they had the kickoff that started on Wednesday.
Oh.
And it was called the Kitty Parade. So it happened on Wednesday.
Oh, there were two parades.
Yeah, but the Kitty Parade was a very small parade.
Sure.
It was mostly... I believe like the elementary schools and things like that, that was in it. And it wasn't long at all. And so, but what that did, it was that kicked off. Was it Wednesday or Thursday? One of those days. I can't remember. But then, because that kicked off the carnival. It's when the carnival started.
The carnival was there when I moved here.
Yeah. But the carnival used to be here at the park. At Recreation Park.
Rec Park, okay.
Yeah.
Because when I came, it was at library.
And you also, through the schools, you got also special passes and stuff.
Tickets to get on the rides and stuff.
Yes, yes,
cool.
Yes. That's what happened. And then, I mean, you had to arrive early for the parade on Saturday. Because you couldn't see the sidewalks at all.
That's amazing.
And back then, that was the big parade. And the Christmas parade was a little small, reeky deaky.
Really?
I mean,
and now it's
No. I don't mean it in that terms. I mean that the number of people that came out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
got it.
Because the parade was
But now
good.
It's opposite.
And now so it's now, opposite.
Yeah.
You know?
So, and I know I was a president of the Monrovia-Duarte Association for a while, and I saw the crowds dwindling every year that we would go down the street for Monrovia days, and I think they got kind of tired of seeing all the. What are they called? The highfalutin people, you know, all the elected officials and all dignitaries. So I think they got kind of tired of seeing all the dignitaries and they wanted to see their kids, right? And this wasn't a parade that focused on the kids. So that's why the Christmas parade is so popular.
But that's what it used to be because I don't know what school it was because people were, that was the next largest parade. Outside of the Rose Parade.
Floats and everything, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Because the Baha'is of Monrovia, we've had two floats in the Monrovia Day Parade.
Very cool.
Yes, because one of the floats was made in our backyard. Okay?
There's pictures.
Do I have those pictures? There's pictures of them building that float in our backyard.
Oh, really?
And it's funny because as it was coming down, everybody thought it was a big birthday cake, but we had instructed the house of worship that's in Wilmette, Illinois. And then, I mean, we didn't think of that, but then as we were looking, I go, it does look like a big birthday cake. Because the dome is gold, and then the building is white, you know, and
yeah,
then
it
has these different pillars, 9 pillars all the way around. You see, so it was, yes.
Well, so you have lived here for a while, and you've seen so many changes, right? I mean, I've lived here since 87, and I personally have seen so many changes, but you grew up here, so you saw it go from really thriving to not so good, and then thriving again, right? I got her speechless.
Well, there's things that I see now that I really don't like.
Like the development that's going on?
Yes.
I totally understand that.
Yes, yes. Because where the hotel is, right there on that corner, mm-hmm. I live right there.
Yeah.
And that was, I mean, actually...
Took your view away?
That... Where the bank and all that is, that Safeway Market used to be right there. My mom, we would walk through the alley, and Jean's Grinder used to be on the other side.
I remember that. I heard that. I didn't know. I didn't
hear
that.
Yes, and actually, that was, we got tired of eating hamburgers. There would be a special thing. And so I remember Joni and I walking over there, and then he says, you know, you might want to try the meatball sandwich. And then That was it. Okay, that
and
was
he's
it.
Still working.
I know.
It's hard to believe.
I know.
Just so you know, there's going to be a meeting coming up on February, I think it's 25th, at City Hall about the development going on Myrtle. So you might want to attend that meeting. So I'll send you the information.
Okay.
But the Old House Group, or the Monrovia Historic Preservation Group, is putting it together.
Okay.
So
do you know what time it's going to be?
5:30, I think. Or 5:30. I'll look at the date.
Okay. I hope it's not the 25th.
I'll check and I'll let you know.
Okay.
But yeah.
Okay. Okay.
So let's get back to you. Let's get back to you. What is your favorite thing about Monrovia? I already told you. You already said the Monrovia Day.
Oh, okay.
Monrovia Day.
And the people.
And the people.
Yeah.
The people here are pretty amazing.
And the people.
I love that everybody is accepting and not judgmental towards others and generous and giving. Speaking of generous and giving, you are one of the most prolific volunteers in this city that I have ever met. And that I always watched you from afar before I got to meet you in person. And I think I only met you in person through Chris Lowe's.
Yes.
Because we did the city council recap together. And that was my first time meeting you in person. And it was like I knew you forever because you're so amazing. But what got you into being a volunteer or, you know, a community activist?
Well, my parents.
Really?
Yeah. They were heavily involved in the community. When I mean heavily involved, they were... they were in the background. They were supportive people. My mom served at PTA. She was on the PTA. And you know, so interesting thinking back, thinking about Santa Fe, Mrs. Reeves was the principal, and she had dinner at our house several times.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So you couldn't get in trouble very easily because she would tell your mom and dad?
Oh, I didn't get in trouble.
Oh, you didn't get in trouble?
No, not me, no. Because I don't like getting in trouble.
Oh, me either. That's a joke.
So, yeah. Oh.
Were you the oldest, true. The youngest? Where
no,
were you
no,
in the
no.
middle?
No. I'm the second to the oldest.
Second to the
yeah,
oldest.
Yeah, Joni is the oldest. And Joni and I are 11 months apart.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so like right now, like my birthday is in 5 days. And then her
Happy
and I.
Birthday.
Thank you. And her and I, and it's so funny because they never ask us, we never was asked how old you are until after my birthday. So then
you
we're
were the
same age.
That's funny. And everybody thought you were twins.
Yes,
but you didn't
yes.
look a thing alike.
Well, when we were younger, you know, maybe because we were 11 months apart, you
yeah.
know, that we were dressed that way. And it's also interesting that when she passed away, you know, that was I can't even describe that pain, you know. And then I thought, oh, snap, this is probably what twins feel
yeah.
when one passes
so
away. Yes, because it was so funny. I was living in Northern California for a minute, and her and I, we bought the same outfit, and then but we didn't
coincidentally
know it. Yeah, we didn't know because once I moved back, her son Justin was playing football, and we arrived and I looked, I go
that's so
the
fun.
Only thing was different is that I don't know which one had what, but she had either a green or a white turtleneck and I had the opposite color.
That's funny. So speaking of Joni, I know she passed away a few years ago, but you do an annual fundraiser.
Yes. Yeah.
So she passed away from, I don't know how to say that. What?
Pulmonary hypertension.
Pulmonary hypertension.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's something to do with the lungs,
Yes, yes. That's the pressure in the lungs.
So you do, it's called Breathe Monrovia?
O2Breathe Walk.
O2Breathe Walk.
Yes.
And when is that?
That's held in November, because November is Pulmonary Hypertension Month.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and actually Joni started the walk.
Pulmonary hypertension is a rare lung disease that is often mistaken for asthma, sleep apnea, and COPD.
Joni started the walk before the the association got involved.
Oh, okay.
She did it herself.
On her own.
She was a support group, her and her co-support group person, Susie Alvarez. They started the walk. And the interesting thing about it, it was in April. And the day of the walk, of the walk was April 12th. And that is actually the same day that our mom passed away. And Joni walked, because there's two routes for you to walk around Library Park, go to Myrtle and walk all the way down to Olive, then cross the street and then come back up.
God.
I'm so excited about this year. We're going to go all the way to Huntington and come back.
Wow.
Yes, and then this year, I already talked to both chiefs, Alan and
Jeremy.
Yeah, if they could form a team.
Oh, that's a great idea.
Yes, I emailed them straight away. I talked to them. And so I go, okay, Barbara, you got this. Enough in advance. Okay.
Good.
You know. So, but anyway, and Joni was able to walk the whole thing. I mean, James is behind her with the
oxygen.
Wheelchair.
Oh, yeah.
I think at the time she still was on oxygen.
Yeah. So speaking of the chief, I was rereading your interview this morning, and one of the questions is, if you could have lunch with anybody in the world, who would you pick and where would you go? And you picked Chief Alan San Victoris.
Yeah, because we were...
I thought that was so cute. Does Alan know that?
Yes, because we keep talking about we need to go to lunch.
So you told him that you said that on the interview?
No, I didn't.
I'm not sure he reads that. Oh, he must read it.
No, we said this a long time ago. Because there was a while back that I interviewed him, and he was all nervous. I said, no, it's okay. Because I interviewed him separately on my show, Excellence in All Things. And then I interviewed him, the mayor, Tom Adams, at the time. And then the superintendent, Kathy Therosian, and oh gosh. And at the time, the president of the board was Terrence. And because we were having the shootings, and then my sister-in-law, Tracy, was at principal at another school, and I was at a meeting, and she got this call. She goes, Barbara, I gotta get out. I have this, I don't know how many way call, because they got a threat up. I go, and that just made me think. I go, well, This just a handful of us.
Yeah.
I said, so, let me do this. So then I called all of them together.
Good idea.
And so it was funny because we were out in the lobby. He goes, you don't have to worry about Barbara. Barbara's easy.
But when you receive something from your own community, you know,
that's what counts.
Yeah.
That's what counts.
Yeah. she makes you feel really comfortable.
Yeah.
Because he had an interview with Ralph. And Ralph, you know Ralph.
Oh, yeah. I got interviewed by Ralph a couple of times. He was a tough one.
Yeah.
I'm not going to be tough. Yeah. I promise.
So that's what he said. But yes, that's probably why I said that, because we keep saying it.
That's so cute.
Yes.
I just love it. I love Alan, too. I've known all the police chiefs since I moved here, but of all the police chiefs I've known, Alan has been the friendliest, the nicest.
Well, there was another thing, because right after Joni passed, I mean, I get a call from the police. I go, oh, snap, the police, what are the police calling me for? And then, so, because she was supposed to do something that it was a video that they actually have put together, and they won something. And so I said, oh, okay. And so I came, and then my car was in the shop at the time. So I took the Foothill Transit, and then we finished early. And so it was Chief Hunt at the time.
Uh-huh. Oh, I liked him too.
Yes, yes. Oh, so
he
smooth.
Yes. You would never know he was with the police or Alan. I mean,
I know. Exactly.
Just not that typical what you expect of a police person.
And so I thought, oh, I'm going to just sit here until my time. And so he goes, well, where you live? I said, actually, right down the street. If my knee was better, I could have walked, you know. And he goes, I'll take you. And I go, the police chief is giving me a ride home.
I love that.
You know, I and know that's is Monrovia.
It's
yes.
totally Monrovia. Yes. I just love that.
Yes. So I thought, wow.
So I also read in the interview that I did with you earlier, I asked you where in the world you would like to go that's on your like bucket list. Where would you like to go? And do you remember what you said?
I think I said Africa.
You did.
Yeah.
So tell me why you would like to go to Africa.
Well, you know,
I think that's so.
I love the colors. I love the art. I love the just everything about it.
What part and, of Africa would you like
well,
to
you know,
visit?
Well, you know, it's interesting because I have a friend that has a store in Altadena, and he's from Nigeria. So there was many years that I was helping them do things. So I'm seeing all this artwork come in, and I've done some pieces myself, which I'm totally shocked that I go, wow, this doesn't look bad. This looks pretty good actually, you know.
Hidden talent.
Yes, yes. Well, I actually attribute that to our former teacher when I taught at Foothill Preschool, Jeannie Tyler, because she unlocked the artist in the whole staff.
Because that's what rock painting did for me. I had no idea.
Yeah,
that I
was yes. At. It's beautiful pieces.
Oh, thank you. Well, my brother-in-law's from Nigeria. So I get he got me a dashiki when he went home, and I mean it was just like really.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you call it dashiki is because being there, you know, it's a shirt.
It's a shirt, right?
Only in America that we call it a dashiki.
Really, I wonder why.
I have no idea. Huh. You know,
because
we hear
because
goes,
they're
how
so
many
beautiful.
But it still is a shirt.
Yeah, it is. It's a shirt.
You know, so I thought, wow, and then. Just the bright and vibrant colors.
Gorgeous.
I love color. And then, you know, in Nigeria, they're really flamboyant in everything.
They are.
And I love that.
And the accent is so awesome. Yeah. I love listening to my brother-in-law
talk. The headdress, like I have two geles. I have them. Yes. And actually,
should take a picture of yourself in one of those.
I do have a picture.
Oh, cool.
Matter of fact, I was so nervous. I was determined that's what I wanted to wear. And so to one of Monrovia-Duarte Black Alumni Gala, I wore it.
Oh,
and
I love
go,
that.
Oh, my goodness. And it was funny because it's big. And I couldn't get in the car. I go, oh, I have to do it. I'm squirting that.
Because once you put it on, you couldn't take it off?
No. And then at the time, also, I don't know if I could fit it now. That's only because I had dreads.
Oh.
And so
I would love
it was,
to see
it was,
you with those.
It was fitted. And so a lady, I mean, they said it was easy. No, it's not.
They lied. Well, speaking of the Monrovia-Duarte Black Alumni Association, MDBAA for short, I know you are very involved in that project, that program, that association. So tell us about the association, and because it's Black History Month, I know that you are putting some events together. So if you could tell us a little bit about MDBAA and what you have planned for the next couple of weeks during Black History Month.
Well, really excited because this year we are a nonprofit and been, this is the 31st or 32nd year, and it was started by a group of people that graduated from Monrovia and Duarte, and they kind of got tired of meeting up. Two things. Kind of got tired of meeting up at funerals. And at the time, they realized there was not also a lot of our Black students getting scholarships.
Oh.
So that really was the big thing. Those two things was being able to provide scholarships. And it's the interesting thing is that started off, you know, with $50 because, you know, it was coming out of their pocket.
Sure.
And so, and only giving a few out till now, you know, we give out between $1,000 and $1,500 to a student.
Oh.
And giving between...
A Monrovia or Duarte student.
Yes, yes, okay. Yes.
How did it end up being both Monrovia and Duarte?
Because
was it from when the high school was
Monrovia-Duarte? No, because it started from people that graduated from both high schools.
Okay. And you just got together.
Yes, yes. Besides, you know, like you said, it was... Three. It was Monrovia,
right,
Duarte, and Arcadia.
Yeah.
And then, you know, once Arcadia got their high school, then it became just MD. And then, you know, Monrovia, Duarte, Kwaisa kept saying with Arcadia, depending on where you live, you walk across the street and you're in that city.
Yeah.
You know. And then, you know, the other thing, especially with Monrovia and Duarte, you know, you have relatives in both those cities,
sure,
and stuff like that. So...
And so what do you have coming up in the next
weeks? Well, actually, I can't say tonight, but anyway. What we have coming up is at the library on February 17th that we are having, what is their name? Anyway, we're having an entertainer coming in and doing storytelling, and I think she's going to do a little drumming.
For the kids.
For the students. For the children. And then we're having a craft. It always turns out to be three different activities, but unfortunately, the Reader's Theater didn't come through this year, which is fabulous. But anyway, and then we have... Really excited that actually that's going on right now. If you have a student in Clifton or Santa Fe, they're learning about Robert Hayden, which was the first Black poet laureate.
Oh.
And the interesting thing about him is that his poetry changed. He had a different view because he became a Baha'i, and so you'll see, if you look at his work, you see the shift that he made in talking about injustice as well as trying to bring people together as well.
And that's the Baha'i faith.
Yes, that
credo, right?
Yes, yeah. yes.
Okay.
And then we have, super excited about this.
Okay.
That at both our middle schools, I Dream Society, because we usually have, this is actually our second year of having something that in the schools, in the classroom,
okay,
that's being taught. And we do an afternoon program. And so this year we partnered up with I Dream Society.
Which is Chris Lose's group.
Which is Chris Lose's group, yes, his organization. And so they are doing the afternoon. And
And he's a fantastic
host and MC. Yeah, and they are going to be doing, I wish I could remember the name of this artist, which I think he is Nigerian.
Oh, I have
But he does, his art is with the pen. So the students will be creating this art with the pen.
Excellent.
Yeah. So that is happening at the schools, at the middle schools. So if anybody out there, if you have a student in either one of those schools, that's what they'll be getting.
Okay.
And then we're just ending Black History Month because we've also have extended and during Women History Month.
Which is next month.
Next month, yeah, exactly. And so our luncheon is on the 25th, and that would be at Second Baptist Church.
Oh, it's at Second Baptist this year.
Well, because of the elections.
Oh.
Yes. So, and that...
Oh, they have all the voting stuff up,
yes,
at the community center.
Yes, and that's where we had to switch. And we were going... Oh, snap, what is bigger, you know,
sure,
what we have big here. And so, anyway,
That's your major fundraiser every year, right?
Well, actually, we have two major.
Have two.
It's the gala,
uh-huh,
which is in November,
and the
luncheon.
Lunch. Okay.
Yes, yes.
I went to
yes.
the lunch last year. I missed the gala because I was sick.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Remember?
That's right,
yeah.
That's right.
So, on the scholarships, just because I'm curious, and people out there need to know, is it for high school students that are going to college, or is
well,
it?
You know what? This particular year, we've got a donation that this individual stated that he would like for his money to go, toward any student that was even going into a trade school.
I like that.
Me too.
That's a very good
idea.
Yeah,
because, you know, not every, we need our mechanics.
Yeah.
We need our plumbers.
Absolutely. And they those are good paying jobs.
They absolutely are.
Sometimes better than the college graduates get, right?
I know. So I was so happy because, you know, when especially if you have a specific donor and
they target what they want.
Yes. Because, you know, we have one that actually is kind of broken up because one part of it to go to an athlete.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah. And then the other or academics or whatever. But, you know, this time around that he put that in there. I go,
great.
Oh, this is absolutely wonderful.
Well, I know that you and I could sit here and talk for two hours.
I know it.
But this is a half hour show, so we're
okay. We're
getting close to the end.
Okay.
So if somebody wants to attend the luncheon that's coming up in 2 weeks from today, how do they find out about it? Just go to mdbaa.org?
Well, if they're on Facebook,
okay,
they can go to our Facebook page, or they can look it up on what do you call it? Eventbrite.
Eventbrite.
Yeah,
okay.
Because
so
we
just
have
look
a page,
up Monrovia-Duarte Black Alumni Association.
Yes.
And that's February the 25th, starting at 11?
No. It's at
2:30. 2 o'clock.
Yeah, okay. Because, you know, we're at the church.
Right. Okay. All right. So I can't believe that we went through a half an hour so quickly, and I know I didn't get to all my questions, so I might have to interview Barbara again. But thank you so much
for being here with me,
Barbara. I just love spending time with you. So I hope you've enjoyed this edition of Faces of Monrovia. If you have not heard of this program, or if you haven't checked out the website, you can go to thefacesofmonroviaca.com, and you can read all the interviews I have there. There are over 100 people in Monrovia that I've interviewed, and more to come. If you want to go to YouTube and check out the KGEM station or channel, you can see all the prior interviews that I've done with the people who I've interviewed live. And if you know somebody or you yourself would like to nominate yourself, please go to the website and click on the nominate tab and send me an email and let me know that you'd like to be one of my interviewees, and I would be happy to send you the questionnaire. So we start online, and then if I can find people to do live interviews, some people don't want to do it, but people like Barbara do, then we can move on from there. So thank you very much for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.